Good morning, and welcome to the Lord's house for worship today. It's good to look out and see many of you in person, and also good to have so many worshiping with us via the web stream, and we ask God's blessings to be upon you all as well. I'm going to try to hit a few announcements as quickly as possible. I hope that as you came in that you did receive one of the communion kits with your bread and juice for the Lord's Supper, and also please be ready to follow along in our communion service with the insert that's located inside of your bulletin. As we move into this week, I hope that you will stay for lunch today following worship. We're having our covered dish meal and a great time of fellowship immediately following the service on this 151st birthday Sunday for Little Rock Original Free Will Baptist Church. It's been 3 years since we've been able to celebrate it this way, and we're looking forward to our time together following worship. As we look at the week to come, please keep in mind our full Wednesday schedule, deacons meeting on Monday night. We have the Original Free Will Baptist Convention at the Maxwell Center in Goldsboro coming up on Thursday. We have our Women's Sunday next Sunday, and also the second offering that will benefit the Original Free Will Baptist Children's Home. And as we look toward this Friday, please keep in mind that the Deacon's annual pancake and sausage supper to benefit the building fund is scheduled from 5 until 7. We still have tickets available, or if you're not sure just yet, you can pay your $8 at the door. The altar flowers today have been given to the glory of God by Susan Langley, and also in memory of her mother's birthday, and in happy birthday to the Little Rock Church family. Marcy? Youth Convention coming up next Saturday. Registration is at 9, well, this coming Saturday. It wasn't yesterday. It's coming up this week. Saturday the 21st, I'll say it that way. How about that? 9 o'clock registration. It officially gets underway at 10 o'clock. Is that correct? And you need meeting here at 9.
I need someone to drive a van.
Church van driver. And we need kids and even some adults who might like to go, parents and grandparents, to not only chaperone but also to be present, just to experience what the Original Free Will Baptist Youth Convention is all about.
The
deacons? So anybody. It's open to any and everybody. Any other announcements? Well, hearing none, let us now prepare our hearts and our minds to worship God.
Responsive call to worship. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips.
My soul will boast in the Lord.
Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. Let us say the Lord's Prayer together as our invocation. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Our song of celebration is Crown Him with Many Crowns, page 234.
Testament lesson today comes from Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 6. Revelation 21, 1 through 6. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God.
As we turn our focus to the Lord in prayer this morning, I call your attention to the back of the bulletin. You'll see many names reflected there, both within our church family and throughout this community and our own personal families. We continue to lift up the family of Mrs. Joyce Bridgers as we had her life celebration and homegoing service this past Thursday afternoon. Do remember Hambone and Ricky and Kathy and the entire family for the journey to come. We also want to lift up Phil Capps, who's been hospitalized with some complications from a kidney stone. So do remember Phil and Pat this morning. Also, we lift up my extended family, one of my cousins, my mother's cousin, my second cousin, Brad Barrett. I don't know, many of you may have heard of this through the news. There were some storm chasers in Minnesota. Their vehicle had to stop for a down power line and was rear-ended by a tractor trailer. Brad is paralyzed from the nose down. And so there are a lot of decisions that family will have to make. It's a very, very critical situation. He's in a hospital in North or South Dakota, South Dakota. Do remember Brad Barrett. Other names, other needs that are close to you this morning. Remember Joanne? Absolutely. And with Dave's brother for the time being. So a lot of decisions for you all to make as far as long-term care goes. Jimmy Holland, as he has heart surgery tomorrow. Richie?
Remember Phyllis's
dad, Sam Saul? Yes. Okay, we remember Mr. Jim Sorrell. Anyone else?
Ruth Rouse.
Diane?
Remember my mother, Dale Thorpe.
Continue to remember your mother. Perhaps by uplifted hands. God sees each and every heart, and God understands the depths of our needs and our hurts. Would you bow with me for a time of prayer? Lord, those are some of the most beautiful words in all of Scripture. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and ending of all things. And we need those words of assurance, especially in the world in which we live today. There's so many things that fill us with fear and anxiety. Situations which overwhelm us in a number of ways. But you prove to us time and again that you are faithful, that you are forever God who never leaves or forsakes his children, who draws alongside of us in our times of great need. Lord, as we focus on the theme of fear this morning and Jesus' words to the women, do not be afraid. We also need to be reminded of those words for these days because, Lord, to turn on the news, to pick up the paper, to open up our cell phone is to be blown away by so many things, violence and sickness, disasters and accidents. But we know that you are a God for all times and seasons of life, and that's why we come and celebrate you today. Lord, we thank you for Little Rock Original Free Will Baptist Church and the 151 years of ministry that you have blessed us with. Lord, continue to use us to be your faithful witnesses and servants within this community and beyond each and every day. Lord, today we come with so many needs and hurts and challenges that are facing this church family, our own families, and throughout this Lucama community. You know these needs. You're well aware of our hurts even before we call upon your name in prayer. But it's so good when we can come together as brothers and sisters in the faith and shoulder these burdens of life and place them before your throne of grace, knowing that you are sensitive to them and you will come through according to your will and your timing, even though we may not understand when or how all of that will work. We lean upon you for the strength we need for every day. Lord, hear the prayers of our hearts this day. Continue to be with us in this season of worship. And Lord, be with us even beyond this time of worship as we go out to be your hands and feet in this week to come. This prayer we lift up in your Son's most precious and holy name.
Please join me in the celebration of Holy Communion. There's an insert in your bulletin. The call to confession, Romans 3:23, reminds us that all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. Let us offer in humility our prayer of confession. Let us pray. Wondrous and generous God, you have blessed us with gentle rains, glorious sunsets, and sun-warm days. You bless us with loving families, kind friends, and a caring church. Let us receive these gifts with thankfulness and humility. We cannot earn, nor do we deserve, such generosity, but we graciously open our hearts and hands to receive. Forgive us when we are hard-hearted and tight-handed, when we don't let your goodness flow through us, when we hide our talents and turn away from the needs of the world. Release us, O Lord, from fear, and create a contagious spirit of giving that touches the world with hope. Amen. Hear the assurance of pardon. 1 John 1:9 encourages us that if we confess our sins, God is faithful and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thanks be unto God. Join me in the affirmation of faith. Let us begin. We believe in God, who loves us as a parent, searching for us when we are lost, embracing us in our hurt, always looking to celebrate our return home. We believe in the risen Christ, who gathers all the lost and forgotten into a new community and tells them and us we are all forgiven, blessed, and loved. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who empowered the new community of followers to share bread, tell stories of God's love, and turn the world upside down. We are a faith-filled, Spirit-empowered, God-blessed community. May God lead, guide, and direct us for another 151 years. Amen.
As Jesus did long ago, he continues to invite us to his table. The times and location may be completely different than 2,000 years ago in an upper room in Jerusalem, but the meaning, the significance of these moments is still just as important. The scriptures teach us on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he gathered in the upper room with his disciples to share in the Passover celebration. And during that meal, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat, for this is my body broken for each of you." And then in a like manner, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, gave it to the disciples and said, "Take this cup, divide it among you, for this is the blood of the new covenant, my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of all sinfulness." And Paul reminds us today, just as he did the believers in Corinth long ago, as often as we eat this bread and drink of the cup, we proclaim, we celebrate, we remember our Lord's death until he comes again one day. Would you bow with me in prayer? God of love and God of mercy, it is with gratitude in our hearts that we come before you today expressing our thanksgiving for who you are and all that you have done in our lives. Lord, you have graced us in many ways, but perhaps in the most special and significant way through the giving of your Son, Jesus, our Christ, our Lord and our Savior, to be that full and final sacrifice for the sins of humanity. Lord, in these moments together, we ask that you would bless bread and cup. the men and women and children who receive these elements, that it may be a season of reminding, because we all need reminding, because our lives get hectic and busy and frazzled, that we have need of forgiveness, constant forgiveness, each and every day. Lord, search us and know us, purge our hearts of any waywardness, and draw us into right fellowship with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Let us take and eat together." Jesus said, "This is my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of all sins. Let us take and drink together." And together all God's people said, "Amen, amen indeed." At this time, our children are dismissed for their time of junior church with Miss Marcy, so you all can come forward at this time to go next door. Our sermon text for this morning is taken from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28, and this morning we'll be looking at verses 5 through 10. Matthew chapter 28, verses 5 through 10. In these Sundays following Easter that we know as Eastertide, we are recalling some of the afterwords of Jesus, some of those things that he said to disciples and other individuals following the resurrection. So much of what Jesus said and did prior to the crucifixion and resurrection are vitally important to the living of our faith, and so often we neglect that which Jesus had to say following those events. We may focus on the Great Commission that we find later on in Matthew chapter 28, but we neglect those other words, Jesus inviting us to follow him. Jesus' words inviting us not to be so foolish, but to remember what it meant and what it means for Christ to be our Messiah. And today, as you hopefully caught on in this morning's prayer and as we share this morning through God's Word, is a theme that's vitally important to our world today, especially with all of the uncertainties and fears in the world around us. These words are common throughout the witness of Scripture, and they continue to give us encouragement and new life even in this day and time. May we give ear to the reading of God's Word as found in Matthew 28, verses 5 through 10. "But the angel said to the women, 'Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then quickly go and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you.' So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, 'Greetings.' And they came to worship him, took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me.'" May God add a blessing to this, the reading, hearing, understanding, and living of these words for our days. Thanks be to God. Amen. Germs. Identity theft. Financial collapse, insects, needles, and even zombies. What on earth do all these things have in common? And what kind of a way to begin a Sunday morning sermon? You may be puzzled by this, but the key thing is I have your attention. Or hopefully I do. And apparently it was those very things, along with about 90 other categories, that gained the attention of participants in a survey that was conducted a couple of years ago. It was conducted by Chapman University, and in this particular survey, they were trying to determine the nature of people's greatest fears. What are they and why? Now, usually we think about fear of thunderstorms and snakes, maybe tight spaces, being alone in the dark. There are a variety of things that create fear for us. And to let you know, those did make an appearance on the survey. Although a lot of the things we normally think about were well down the listing. They were spread throughout, but well down the listing. But it's interesting to look at the percentages. You can go online to chapmanuniversity.edu, and there you will find the survey, and it would surprise you. Just all of the things that made it into a listing of people's fears. 95 different categories of fear. And just to let you know, since this has happened in the past couple of years, the top three. Number one was political corruption. Number two was the death of a loved one. And number three, a loved one contracting COVID-19. Now, you may not agree with that listing of the top three. You may not agree with any of those things with which I opened my remarks this morning, but there's one thing that the Chapman University survey does confirm, and that's the fact that we all have our fears. It's natural to being a human being. There's nothing bad about it. There's nothing abnormal. There's nothing evil about fear. It happens to us. And we can even be honest, fear can be a plus. It can have its positive moments in our lives depending on what we do with it and how we allow it to come into us and consume us. It can push us forward to do good things, or it can hold us back and become quite paralyzing. I read an illustration this week that I find quite helpful when I consider fear and the work of fear in our lives. It compares fear to fire. Now, fire has some positives, doesn't it? It can warm our bodies on a frigid night. It can help us cook at a campsite. It can even be used as a signal if we're lost somewhere. But think about the downsides of fire. It can burn human skin if it's touched. It can consume woodlands, homes, and even lives when it becomes out of control. Fire's not necessarily a bad thing. It can be a good thing, but it's all about perspective. It's all about what we do and how it influences us for good or for ill, just like fire can impact our world. It's nothing new. It's been around as long as human history. And maybe that's the reason when you read the Holy Scriptures, both the Old and New Testaments, that time and time and time again, we're encouraged not to be afraid. It's the most common command throughout the witness of Scripture. We read it in both Testaments. We hear it frequently from the lips of Jesus throughout his ministry, and even in this particular moment following the resurrection. Time and again, the Bible tells us, do not let your hearts be troubled. Be strong and fear not. Do not be afraid or dismayed. Fear not, I am with you. When we come to today's text, we encounter a couple of women, Mary Magdalene and Mary the unknown Mary, just simply called the other Mary in today's text. And they've both made their way to the tomb. They're going to do what we might call pay their last respects. They're going to go and witness the empty tomb, much like when we visit the burial site of a loved one. We go by there on special occasions, birthdays, anniversaries, holidays, and we remember those individuals. And even though it had only been a couple of days, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see, went to behold. Maybe they did so as a token of respect for who Jesus was and everything that Jesus meant to them in their lives. Maybe they went to see if all of this was simply an illusion. Maybe everything of Good Friday had never taken place. We don't know, but they were going. And boy, were they surprised, weren't they? They went to that tomb and found it not exactly as it was left before dusk on Friday. No, the tomb was open. And instead of it being a place of death, it very much teemed with life. They went in and to be startled by an angelic being saying, "Greetings. Don't be scared. Don't be afraid in this moment. You're looking for Jesus, but Jesus is not here. He's been raised." So much for going and paying last respects, right? Everything that they were going to do. When we read the other gospel accounts, they had bought spices to go and anoint the body of Jesus. But all of that was for naught in this particular moment. Because they heard words of life, "Do not be afraid. Jesus is no longer here. He has been resurrected." And just to prove the point and to make things even better, he's not here in this tomb because he's gone ahead of you to Galilee. And if you go to Galilee, there you will encounter him face to face as well. Talk about surprise, a little bit of fear, joy. I'm not sure what I would have done in that moment. I don't know exactly how I would have felt given those circumstances. Maybe it would have been like the residents in New York City in that 1984 movie classic Ghostbusters. Oh my word. Oh my goodness. How can this be? What's happening? It doesn't make sense. The man was brutally killed on Friday. What do you mean he's back to life today? And now you're telling me that if I travel down this road toward Galilee, I will find him myself? It seems ridiculous. It's absurd. It doesn't make sense to our normal way of human thinking. But the scripture tells us that they left with haste, feeling fear and joy at the same time. Have you ever been there before? When I think about fear and joy, I guess it takes me back to the day Kelsey was born. Because I knew the great joy of new life preparing to come into this world. I knew what those 9 months had meant for Marcy. I already had a great level of respect for life. But then to know that that life was about to come into the world did something different inside of me. I was excited because those 9 months had been fulfilled. But at the same time, there was that uneasiness. How's all of this going to go? What are the next steps going to look like? It was a mixture of fear and at the same time, great joy. And it was in the midst of that fear and great joy that none other than Jesus himself appeared to the two women. And he offered words of greeting. Some would say it's merely what we would say as hello. But when you think about the way the NRSV translates it, rejoice. It's so much more than greetings. It's so much more than, "Hey, y'all." It's a sense of conveying the joy of the Lord to be upon you. I know that this doesn't seem real. I know this is overwhelming, but it is me. And the women fell before Jesus. They latched onto his feet and they began to worship their Lord. But then come the words from Jesus that are so important, not only to the women 2,000 years ago, but they are still very, very important, especially for these days. Do not be afraid. Jesus had said those very things when he came walking to the disciples on water. They were on their fishing vessel on the Sea of Tiberias, the Sea of Galilee, and they were uncertain. The water was coming into the boat, and they think there's a ghost headed their way. But then Jesus says, "It's okay. It's me. You don't have to be afraid." When have you needed those words in your life? When have you found your ship at sea, beaten and battered by winds and waves and flooding rains? It doesn't have to be that in a literal sense, but there's definitely something somewhere, and who knows, it might even be within your heart today. It's natural to be afraid, but so many of our fears overwhelm us to the point that we don't know what to do. We don't know where to turn. We don't know how to act. We don't know how to put one foot in front of another. But then Jesus speaks these words, "Do not be afraid." Now maybe you're thinking to yourself at this point, "Preacher, I thought you said moments ago that it's natural as a human being to be afraid of something at some time in life." But then Jesus tells us, "Do not be afraid." So is that a contradiction? I don't believe it for one moment that it's a contradiction. We have to understand what Jesus says in this moment, just as he said it on other occasions, "Do not be afraid." Very similar to his words concerning worry in the Sermon on the Mount. Do not worry about what you're going to eat, drink, what you're going to wear. Don't worry about life. Every day has its own troubles and challenges. And behind that idea, what Jesus is trying to communicate in the Sermon on the Mount is there are going to be things in life that are concerning, things that have a lot of our attention, that we put a lot of mind and effort toward. But what Jesus is communicating there and behind the wording that's used is, do not be controlled by, do not be excessively filled with worry and anxiety. And although it's a different word between worry and fear, the same thing is communicated by Jesus in those various contexts as well. You're going to be afraid, but do not let the fear control you. Do not let fear dominate your circumstances. What are your fears today? And by that, I don't mean snakes. I don't mean insects. I don't mean ghosts. I don't mean anything that was on the Chapman University listing. But at the end of the day, what is it that really hits you right here in the heart? What is it that consumes a lot of your daily thinking? What is it in your life and my life that needs to hear those same words of Jesus? Do not be afraid. It's me. I'm here for you. I'm with you. You're not alone. There's no need to be scared. Yes, it may seem like an overwhelming scenario right now, but you are not alone in this dark and difficult moment. For us, it doesn't have to be witnessing the resurrected Jesus coming and standing before us. Turn on the TV. It might be inflation. How am I going to pay for the groceries, the utilities, put gas in the tank? Could be the circumstances unfolding between Russia and Ukraine. Where is this going to lead? Is this going to create what we've often anticipated, World War III? Maybe it's something that's been discovered within your body, some abnormality and you're waiting for that appointment to have it diagnosed, or you've received the diagnosis and now it's a matter of moving forward with the next steps. It could be anything today. Anything in the world can strike fear into us, and it's not a laughing matter, but it's a matter that God longs to walk with us through. And I believe today that God is still allowing His Son to speak those words of life that we need to hear. Do not be afraid. I want to think back for just a few moments as I close this morning. Today is our 151st birthday Sunday as Little Rock Original Free Will Baptist Church. What must have things been like back in 1871 when a seed was sown in the minds and the hearts of godly people to plant a community church here? Those seed members from over at Union Grove who came here, and eventually seed members who went from here to Daniel's Chapel, to First Free Will Baptist in Wilson, now known as Connect Church. It had to have been an exciting time because God had stirred up something new within their hearts. But I can't help but wonder, was there a little bit of uncertainty? Perhaps even a little bit of fear within their lives because this was a new endeavor. This was taking a leap of faith, stepping out and planting a church. But in spite of any fears they may have possessed 151 years ago, brothers and sisters, we're still here today. Let's think back briefly over the last 2 years. We've been through a pandemic. We've been closed, we've been open, we've been online, we've been closed again, we've been open, we've had singing, no singing, singing again, you name it. We've had a multitude of scenarios over the past 2+ years. Has it been scary? Absolutely. But has God finished with us yet? I don't think so. Let God's new work can continue in our lives as we remain obedient and faithful and we live into those words that He said 2,000 years ago that He still speaks to us even now in these present difficult moments. Do not be afraid. It is I. You're not alone. You're going to make it. You can do this. Just focus on me. Thanks be unto God. Amen and amen. Today, our hymn of commitment is number 201, Grace Greater Than Our Sin. This morning, brothers and sisters, this altar is open, and it's true for those worshiping online. Let that be your sacred space wherever you are today with God. If you've never accepted Christ and invited Him in to be the personal Savior and Lord of your life, will you come forward? Maybe you would like to recommit your life to following Christ or unite formally with the Little Rock Original Free Will Baptist Church family. Perhaps there are burdens that are pressing in on your hearts and your minds, or even thanksgivings you would like to celebrate with your Heavenly Father. No matter the need, no matter the condition of your heart, this altar is open as we stand to sing hymn number 201. sisters, it's been good to be with you today in person and online. I ask that God would richly bless you and keep you as you go forth to be his servants in the coming days. Would you bow for our benediction, the blessing of today's offering, and the blessing of our meal and fellowship. Our God of compassion and source of all comfort, we thank you for the strength and the gentle reminder that we are not to be afraid. We may experience fears at various times of various levels, but we know that you are with us to give us the courage we need to face whatever it might be. Lord, we so often become overwhelmed and anxious about the things we see in life, and we forget that the words of 2,000 years ago are just as applicable for our living today. Do not be afraid. Lord, we ask that you would bless the tithes and offerings that have been received and will be received. Multiply them for the ongoing ministry of your kingdom here upon earth. Lord, we also ask that you would bless this meal, that you would allow the food to nourish our bodies to your service. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. And if you will go out the narthex and into the front entrance of Heritage Hall.